Hi guys, I'm Pastor Eric, and thank you for coming to another Surge Kids Ministry Training. I'm excited to talk to you a little bit today about something that is a pretty big deal. If you're in kids ministry, you probably know already, discipline is a big deal. How do we handle discipline in today's culture? I know there are a lot of things that can get you in trouble if you don't handle it properly. There are some sticky situations that you can find yourself in if you don't have an idea of how discipline issues should be handled properly. The truth is, you just never know when something is gonna happen that you have to deal with. With kids, every situation is unpredictable. I remember not too long ago, I was teaching about evangelism, and I was teaching the kids about what our responsibility was as Christians. We just can't sit back and make excuses for not sharing our faith. And to help with this, I told them a simple illustration. I told them, imagine you're living across the street from a house, and you look across the street and you realize that the second floor is on fire. I mean, smoke is coming out of the windows, but on the first floor, you can see through the windows, there's a little kid playing video games in the living room, and they're all by themselves, but they have headphones on. And they have no idea that the house is burning down. And I said, you see it happening, and you know if that little one doesn't get out of there, they're gonna be hurt. I mean, that person may even die. And I asked the kids, what would you do? Do you make excuses? Or do you say, I don't know, I don't wanna get involved. It's not really any of my business. If I tried to explain to that little one, she may have questions about some things that I don't have answers to. And you know, we've all heard those excuses before. And listen, there is no good excuse for not sharing your faith. Then I asked the kids, what would you say in that moment? And then all of a sudden, I had a little boy, he raised his hands and he said, this girl is on fire! And the whole place just busted out in laughter. But in that moment, I had a really hard time of getting everyone back. I had an unexpected situation, and you just never know when something like that is gonna happen to you. You may have an unruly kid, or you may have something going on in the classroom, but let me tell you what, discipline is a hot button issue for people who work in kids ministry. Now guys, you know schools have kids all day, every day. They have it a little bit easier being able to set up parameters to figure out this discipline issue. But the church, we've got kids maybe 1 hour a week with kids. So you probably have a difficulty because there is a lack of time where you can set up proper structure to help kids understand what is expected of them. But not only that, schools also have certified instructors who are trained to deal with classroom management, whereas most of us, we're just part-time volunteers, maybe not even full-time. And some of us, we've not been properly trained on how to deal with kids, on how to deal with these serious discipline issues. And to be honest, for most of us, it's not our area of expertise. And the last thing that I wanna do is expect volunteers to come up with a discipline plan all on their own without guidance or expectations. When we do this, strange things are gonna happen. Let me give you an example. Sometimes disciplining kids at church is even discouraged or ignored. I had a kids pastor come up to me one time, and he told me that his senior pastor told him he was never to correct his kids when they misbehaved. And because of that, the kids in his kids church, they ran wild, and they had a very difficult time because there was no discipline in place. Because of that, they were very, very frustrated, and that kids pastor didn't last very long in that position. Or what about this? I had a leader one time that they chose a very bizarre method of handling things. I have a friend, and she used to be a kids pastor in Tennessee. And she got to this church, and there was a lady who had been serving in Sunday school for a very, very long time. And over that time, she found out that this teacher had a very strange way of disciplining her children. Whenever she had a kid who was unruly or acting out, she would go over and she would lick the kid's face. I mean, everyone in the room would go, ooh, that's gross. And guys, it was gross. And let me tell you what, if left unattended, our volunteers will figure out something, and it could be as strange as licking a kid. Maybe your volunteers just go straight to the way that they were disciplined as a child, from what they learned from their parents, and maybe they scream at them, or maybe it's something crazy. But let me just say, guys, none of these are the preferred route. So how can children's ministry volunteers do what we're called to do without being trampled on by misbehaving kids? You see, I think understanding why kids misbehave is the first step to eliminating discipline problems. So let me give you some common reasons for misbehavior in kids' ministry. Number one, a desire to belong. One of the kids' greatest desires is to connect with their peers. Sometimes a child's misbehavior, it results from a mistaken assumption that inappropriate behavior will help gain peer recognition. When kids feel disconnected from the group, misbehavior is often a misguided tactic to actually belong to the group. The kid kind of thinks, well, if I refuse to participate, other people will think I'm cool and then I'll fit in with the group. What's sad is that this is a misguided tactic because kids often will actually shy away from the kid who is causing trouble. Number two, lack of direction. If you have unclear rules or inconsistent enforcement or even lack of consequences, all these things can just ignite misbehavior. If kids believe they'll get away with inappropriate behavior, they're going to do it. If there's a history of tolerance without repercussions, the spark of misbehavior can just spread like a wildfire throughout your kids' ministry. Number three, environment. Sometimes the room arrangement encourages kids to actually act out. Seating arrangements and physical distractions and even space issues can lead to a child's poor behavior choices. I had a kids pastor friend who once was, he had his kids just, they were constantly goofing off. And in their chairs the entire time they were moving and goofing off and the chairs were a distraction. The leader, one Sunday, removed all the chairs and had the kids sit on the floor. This simple change in the room eliminated the distraction of the chairs, and the kids were instantly more engaged in the teaching. Now, it can sound like a drastic change, but this helped create focus, and it lengthened the attention span of the children. Number four, boredom. If kids aren't engaged in learning, they're going to engage in something else, and an unprepared leader is just a doormat waiting to be stepped on. When a leader is reading from a script and is not being interesting, the kids will lose interest and the kids will actually engage in something else. Maybe you're not in a classroom setting and you think, well, I work great. Pastor Eric, you don't understand. I'm a great greeter, or I work in security. How does this apply to me? Well, I think this area actually applies to us all, because all of our goals for each and every single one of us is to provide a safe and secure environment for our kids to learn about Jesus. And I think we can all agree that discipline is needed if we're going to communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ effectively to our kids. Now guys, successful discipline comes down to two words: clear expectations. Now, there is no way that kids can be expected to be held accountable to follow rules that are never clearly communicated to them. Some of you guys get mad at your kids for things that you have never told them not to do. You just jump on them as soon as something doesn't please you, or as soon as you see something that you don't like. When setting expectations, we need to do the following things. Keep it simple. Don't develop so many rules that kids can't remember them from week to week. In our elementary service, we have 6 rules, and they're really easy to memorize, and at the beginning of every service, we go over all of our rules, and we clearly say, if you break this rule, this is the consequence for breaking that rule. Number two, keep it consistent. Wavering in your discipline approach weekly can cause confusion with your kids. Being extra sensitive and then boom the next week, calling down on everyone week after week, and then boom, we're gonna be carefree. It just allows all these disruptions that will not help your kids at all. They won't know how to behave. So let me encourage you, be consistent. Number three, keep it fair. Many of our kids face life with a list of personality disorders and issues that are just attached to them. Each week may bring a different set of behavioral problems and challenges into your class. In the heat of the moment, it can just be really easy to label a child instead of addressing inappropriate behavior. You decide, well, that's just a problem kid, instead of saying, hey, let's talk about your behavior. Always tell them, this was a bad choice you make, but you are not a bad kid. You can make better choices, and I believe in you. And listen, God can help you make the right choice next time. It's very important to take care of comforting a child about their misbehavior. Announcing it to the class that Sally's a chatterbox when she constantly talks out of turn doesn't model respect and actually may inflict damage, just hurting that girl's sense of self. Instead, we need to remind Sally one-on-one that the class rules is to be respectful, and when she talks out of turn, her behavior is disrespectful, and there will be consequences for her disrespectful actions. Number 4, consequences. If you want your kids to follow your policies, then follow through with the established consequences. Now, consequences help kids own their behavior, and it teaches them to make better choices. Here are the established steps to follow when applying consequences. Number 1, remind the child of the rule that they have broken. Number 2, if a rule is then broken again, I give a child an official warning. Number 3, I move the child to a different seat. Sometimes the very act of just moving them to a different place in the room will help create focus. Number 4, time out in service. When I do a timeout for a child, I ask them, how old are you? And I put them in timeout for as many minutes as years they are old. It's a great focus moment for the kids. They always take it very seriously. Number 5, if a child is still acting up or there's some discipline issues that need to take place, I have a kids pastor discussion. I sit down one-on-one with that child, not just a leader, but I sit down as the kids pastor to let them know that I mean business and they can't keep breaking the rules. If the problems persist, number 6 says we have a parent meeting. I, as the kids pastor, will meet with the child and the parent after service to inform the parent of the child's misbehavior or even the disciplinary actions that were taken for the day. If problems still persist, number 7, there is a suspension for 1 week. Now, this is very important, that you make sure to communicate to the child that you love them, that you want to make sure that you want them to see and you want them to know that you think they can make better choices. Tell them that you want them to see that it's a privilege to be in kids' church and how much fun it is. So next week, you want them to go to church with their parent and they can realize that it's a great privilege to be in kids' church. I say something like, you won't have as much fun. They don't teach on a kid's level. You may even have trouble understanding the lesson, and you're gonna see how blessed you actually are to be over here in kids' church. Then the following week, you can come back. If problems still persist then, number 8 says there will be a suspension for 3 weeks. And that's a really come to Jesus moment where the parent understands this is a serious problem and I need to get this under control. And then number 9, if problems are still existing, there is a permanent suspension from kids ministry. Above all, let's take a positive approach. I want you to know this, you get what you celebrate. When you see a child doing something well, celebrate that. Something I do that works really well is I tell their parent when they do something right. I know as a parent I've had one of my kids who just, you know, they got into some trouble. And if I constantly come into the room and all I hear is my kid did this or my kid did this and it's only negative, it can be disheartening. And I've seen families actually disconnect from church when that happens. Celebrate the child to the parent in front of the parent. Celebrate when kids behave well. If we take a positive approach to discipline by celebrating good behavior as well as correcting inappropriate or wrong behavior, I guarantee you that you will be shocked about how well things go. Guys, I hope and I pray that this lesson challenged you to take discipline in children's ministry seriously. I believe 100% that these practical tips will help your ministry become even more effective. Remember, I love you. God loves you. Now go out and change the world for Jesus. Bye, guys.